Very good morning to all of you. I first of all thank Dr. Arun for giving me this opportunity to be a part of the IC. The talk is on simplifying the strabismus. So the first talk would be on simple equipments for strabismus practice. When we talk of practice, we usually think of two things. One, the evaluation. Two, the management. So we would be dividing this talk in this way. Equipments would include those required for motor evaluation, which would be the fixation targets, the occluders, the prisms, the red and green glasses. For the sensory evaluation, bar investigations, which would include Wirth 4 dot test, Bergolini striated lenses, the stereopsis charts, the Hess charts, the goniometers, etc., and those required for surgery. We would cover each of it in detail. Let's look at the first thing, that the fixation targets. For any squint evaluation, the first and foremost thing that we would need is a fixation target. The target should be recognizable, it should be resolvable. Two, it should hold the object or the patient's interest depending on the age of the patient. It should be larger than the threshold visual acuity. If the visual acuity is 6-6, we use a fixation target of 6-12 on a Snellen chart, and it should stimulate the accommodation. Essentially meaning, torch would not be a sufficient fixation target and should not be used. So the fixation target, so do we actually need, this is not moving, can I have the next slide, please? So when we talk of the fixation targets, do we need anything extra or do we have something in our ophthalmic OPD already? All of us have, can you play the video, please? All of us have Snellen visual acuity charts, which are a part of every ophthalmic OPD. So these fixation targets, either Snellen letter charts, Snellen number charts, or other parts of the e-charts can be used as a fixation. In a younger child, we have these cartoon pictures, which are a part of Snellen charts again, which could be used as a fixation targets. In a very younger child, in a verbal child, which could use Allen picture charts or Lee symbols, which are again a part of Snellen chart. So we don't need any extra equipment, which is already there in our OPD, can be used as a fixation target. Coming to the next thing, apart from the fixation targets for the distance, we would also need fixation targets for the near. So the fixation targets for the near could be, the near vision charts, which are normally available. Then we have the Lang's fixation. I'm sorry about this. So the near vision charts could be the near vision charts and the Lang fixation stick, which is specially designed for this purposes. In children or in infants, we could use the toys as well. These Lang's fixation charts are two things. One, it has pictures on one end, and the other end, it has all the number charts also, which could be used. In very young children, we could use the squeaky toys, which come very handy, and they not only make noise, but also can be stopped to make noise to use as a fixation targets. Apart from this, do we have anything else which could be used as a fixation target? All of us have smartphones in our pocket. So can we use the smartphones for squint evaluation? Yes. We have a lot of smartphone videos and apps which are available, which have nursery rhymes, which come very handy in every infant when we have to examine the squint, which could act as a fixation target because they hold the child's attention very well. So this come very handy. Apart from the fixation targets, the next thing we would need would be the occluders. The occluders could be the standard occluders, which are solid occluders, or it could be the translucent occluders like the Spielmann's occluder. So these occluders help us evaluate the squint. And these, apart from the solid occluders, the translucent occluders are specifically used in evaluation of both latent nystagmus or in the presence of a DVD, like we see in this video, when a DVD of the right eye is being shown, apart from the latent nystagmus. Do we need these occluders all the time? Not really. We could get away without using the occluders also. So what we need is basically our hands to be used as an occluder. So what we, in very young infants, they usually get offended with the occluders because we are introducing another thing in front of the child's eye. So we could use our thumb in infants to use as occluder and thus get the measurements done. In a very little older children, what we could use is our palms to record the, to measure the squint. Once we know the presence of squint is there by our fixation targets and occluder, what we would need next is to measure the prism, measure the squint. How do we measure the prism, squint? With the help of prisms, either a loose prism or a prism bars could be used to measure the squint. Once we measure the squint, what we would need is to do the sensory evaluation as well. The Wirth 4-dot test is the most commonly done sensory evaluation test in the squint clinic. Do we need an extra equipment again for the Wirth 4-dot test? No, this is already impregnated in the Snellen visual acuity chart, which would be used for Wirth 4-dot test. We would need just a pair of red and green glasses to be worn by the child or the patient in question to measure the sensory evaluation. And we would use a Wirth 4-dot torch basically to test it for near. So red and green glasses again, is it a compulsion? Not really, because the retinoscopic trial set itself has red and green lenses which are there as a part of trial set. If we don't have a red and green pair of red and green glasses, we could use this trial lenses in the trial frame and get away doing a Wirth 4-dot evaluation. The red and green glasses is an important thing to have because it could help us not just in Wirth 4-dot tests, but also in stereopsis acuity measurements, in diplopia charting, and the Hess charting. The Wirth 4-dot torch again can be made with the help of a normal torch. Just stick on the color papers along with it with an occluder and that becomes a Wirth 4-dot torch. Then the next important sensory evaluation which we would need are Bagolini striated lenses. These lenses are basically have striations. So how does the light look through when the patient actually sees it as seen with this in this figure? It sees as a line across the point fixation of light. So that is how you can differentiate between an NRC and an ERC as well. The next important thing would be the stereopsis chart, which could be TNO test or a Titmus fly test. I would not be going to assessment of stereopsis, which would be dealt by Dr. Kavita later. So the stereopsis charts, apart from stereopsis charts, we would require red and green glasses or polarized glasses. There are some stereopsis charts where we would not need these polarized lenses or red and green glasses. These are basically line fixation charts or the Frisbee test. This is a near stereopsis being done. What is important to note as a child is wearing the glasses, on the top of it the polarized lenses are worn and the stereopsis is being checked. The younger the child or the age of the child is not a deterrent to do the stereopsis acuity measurement. In fact, the infants or the children respond very well to the stereopsis acuity measurements. It's just the mind block that the children may not be able to respond to it, but they respond beautifully well with respect to the stereopsis charts as well. The next important thing is to measure the abnormal head posture. What we could use is basically a goniometer. This is what we have made in our own clinic. Use two scales and mount it on a 360 degree protractor and use that to measure the abnormal head posture, both the turns, tilts, or the chin up or chin down posture. The next important thing what we would need apart from the goniometers and the thing would be the red and green glasses to measure the Hess charting. The Hess charting again helps us to differentiate between two things, the incompetent squint to make it a paralytic or a restrictive squint, and also to note the amount of movement or the extraocular motility which is there in a patient. So you have the, I'm sorry about the contrast, the patient wears the red and green glasses. And then the assistant points out the green light and we are able to mark it in both the eye, either with right eye fixing and left eye fixing separately. Then the red and green glasses again are useful to do the diplopia charting. The diplopia charting again doesn't need any specific or special equipments. You have the red and green glasses already. What you need is just a retinoscope. Use the streak retinoscope light, mount, show it on a wall. The patient is seated 1 meter away and ask the patient as to how the patient is seeing it. And thus, the diplopia charting can be done without any need for the extra equipments in the clinic. Then the not so commonly used are the synoptophore for the torsional measurements or the Lee screen and Lancaster red-green test, which are optional to have. the other things which would be needed, just before we think of managing any squint, what we would need is to do a forced duction test, not only to differentiate between the two tests, but paralytic or a restrictive strabismus, but also to plan out which muscle to be done. What we need again is the routine tooth forceps, which are in the cataract surgery equipment set, or a Hoskin's forceps, and perform a forced duction test, which comes very handy. Apart from the routine conjunctival scissors and the tooth forceps which are required, the squint set would have a series of muscle hooks, so Von Grafe's, the Jemison's, and the teaser's hook, apart from the retractors and the calipers. What we need is a special sutures, or they commonly use the ones which are used in oculoplasty surgery, 60 or 80 vicryl. Sometimes we also use a 50 ethypon. These are the various instruments which are being used. Also important is to have a pair of Moody's fixation forceps, when we would avoid the use of an assistant and you could get away doing the surgery yourself. So evaluation of squint is akin to mathematics, where 2 plus 2 is always 4 and it can never be 5. This is a picture of one of my patients who's got used to me examining her every time. She knows that a fixation target is to be used and a prism for evaluation. As soon as I finish her check, she wanted to check her dad, playing my role in it. Beyond all this, it's not the equipments which make a difference, but how we interpret it. As the saying goes, the eyes cannot see what the mind does not know. Thank you very much.